Hello. Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest is one of my favorite authors, and she knows that possibly to tell anyone how to do a successful book, it's beginning with Three Girls Who. Well, her Three Girls Who are what she titles the book, China Dolls. My guest is the author Lisa C., and the book is published by Random House. Welcome, Lisa.
Thank you. Thank you for having me again.
Oh, thank you, because this way I could spend a week reading. It's not a fast read. It's a sort where you go in and you really, in a sense, live with these people. Mm-hmm. Wow. The three being Helen, who's from a very wealthy Chinese family that they have a compound in San Francisco.
Right.
But they had lived in China prior to coming to San Francisco.
Correct.
That is Helen, and they're all beautiful. But Helen had never been a dancer before.
Right.
So when she meets Ruby, who is a hot sensation, and Grace, who's sort of a cool Midwesterner, who absolutely fell apart when she says, I never ate Chinese food, and I never knew how to use chopsticks.
Mm-hmm.
These are your three heroines.
Yes. And they're based on these young women who came to San Francisco in the 1930s to work in Chinese American nightclubs and this was the first time they'd ever had these nightclubs. So most of the performers, and especially these young women, had never danced before. They were just looking for people who would be willing to dance. And for the traditional Chinese girls, they weren't allowed to show their arms. They weren't allowed to show their legs in public. So this was really something that was way outside. And these young women, the real life women, really broke the mold.
Yeah. Well, even in Helen's case, when the girls, Ruby and Grace, have taught her how to do the step that's going to be the first show, Play With Me, it's called, I think was the song. He only says, you're going to shame the family. And she says, but they're going to pay me X amount, and I can help put my brother through college. And the father doesn't say anything. He just sort of walks away.
Yes, yes. Again, these were based on so many stories that I'd heard. And many of these young women actually did come from the Midwest or from other towns, like Tucson. There was a woman, Mary Ong Tom, who was one of the eight original dancers at the Forbidden City. And she had come out by herself as an 18-year-old, had no money, and someone said, hey, why don't you go try out at the Forbidden City? And they hired her. And she then continued to dance throughout her career. And even when I interviewed her at age 93, she was still teaching dancer size.
I love that. And also, that was the era of the World's Fair, wasn't it, in
yes.
San Francisco. So Grace goes there thinking, well, I'll get hired for one of the dances. No, she doesn't. She is hired if she wants to go and wear nothing, being naked. Ruby does go because Charlie, who owns the nightclub, he recognizes she's Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
And I hadn't realized, of course I should have, but that there was such an antagonism between Chinese and someone who was Japanese.
Well, in those years especially, because this novel, China Doll, starts in 1938, and the Japanese had invaded China in 1937. And of course, that first invasion, and so many people died, and this book starts not long after what came to be known as the Rape of Nanking, when all of the women, or so many women and young women in Nanking were raped by Japanese soldiers. So this was a time actually of where it's so in the immediate yeah. aftermath of this terrible atrocity that even today people recognize as one of the terrible war atrocities.
Yeah.
And so, but even beyond that, here was China at war with Japan. Mm-hmm. And of course, the Sino-Japanese War will eventually roll right into World War II.
Yeah. And one of the girls, which we'll talk about later, has gone through the hells of war because of it. She was over there, saw her husband stabbed to death and emboweled, as was her child. She lived, but never forgot, never got over the scar.
Well, how could you ever forget?
Yeah.
I mean, you could never forget that. And I felt with her that there had to be a reason why she would be allowed, coming from a very traditional family, be
yeah.
allowed to dance at the Forbidden City. And the, you know, what would make her family allow this girl who was from such a traditional family? And it would be because she had no value. And in Chinese tradition, widows don't have any value. They can be tossed out. I mean, I'm talking about in the old days, not mm-hmm. today, but they could have been yeah. tossed out into the street. They could have been sold into another marriage. They could have been sold also into another marriage and keep her yeah. children. So she had no value and she had no options. And
yeah.
so this actually being able to go dance, even though she was not a professional dancer,
yeah.
gave her a way out.
And her mother still had the bound feet.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, the girls, it's interesting, two can play and three can't. So at certain points, Helen is best friends with Grace, and they are against Ruby. Then Ruby is best friends with Grace, and they are against
right.
Helen. So there is always this constant dynamic going on.
Yes, and you're so right. And that was actually one of the inspirations to write this story this way. Because I had written about best friends for life
mm-hmm.
in Snowflower and the Secret Fan. I wrote about sisters, a pair of sisters, and Shanghai Girls. But in this book, I just thought it'd be so interesting to look at three sisters.
Yeah.
I mean, three friends. And part of what had inspired me to do that was I do so many book events, and the majority of people who come are women. And whenever there are three women in the line coming through to get their book signed, there are always two who are really like whispering,
yeah.
and one is a little bit on the outs. And it just happens over and over and over again. And of course, I've been in friendships like that myself,
yeah.
where I'm either on the in part of the two or I'm way out there.
Yeah.
And so I just thought that would be such an interesting dynamic
mm-hmm.
and how those loyalties do shift sometimes within a day,
yeah.
sometimes year to year, and the misunderstandings that can happen.
And definitely over a man.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
throw a man in there. Yeah. It's going to be trouble.
And one of the men who is thrown into it is a very attractive guy named Joe.
Mm-hmm.
The sort who walks to Stanford or a very good college. And his family is not used to maybe having an Asian girlfriend for him.
Right. And, you know, we have to remember in those days it was against the law in 28 states
mm-hmm.
for Chinese and Caucasians to marry.
Yeah.
So anybody who was trying to get married in those days in that kind of situation
yeah.
was very difficult. So if you were in California, maybe you would go to Mexico to get
yeah.
married, or just go to another state
yeah.
much further east.
And in this particular case, because as I'm talking about this, I remember your other book about the sisters who come to Los Angeles and how badly they were treated by the men in the family.
Mm-hmm.
So these girls were much better off being independent.
Yes, yes. And I think Ruby especially is truly a modern woman. You know, the Grace, I think, coming from the Midwest, has a sort of a little more of an old-fashioned sort of traditional view of the world. And of course Helen comes from such a traditional family, but Ruby, she sees everything I think very much as a modern woman, whether it's from her job, her boyfriend, lover, you know, how she views sex, all of those things. Not that it's like a big wild sex book in
yeah.
here, but that it really gives you this sense of somebody who could be living right now today.
Truly. Because she picks up Sally Rand's fans. She goes, and with that, she has her friends who, in a way, she feels inferior to, but she now is on top.
Yeah, because she's making so much money.
And she's having them paint her body.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, put the makeup on.
Yeah. And that is a bit of sublimating the other person.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely. And then it's going to be something that will comes back at her later. Yeah.
Later on, there are periods.
But Connie, can I just say something, though?
Yeah.
Don't you think sometimes, I mean, we don't like it to happen, but sometimes you do have friends who are trying to put you, under that, I am, you're my best friend, but I am better than you.
Yeah.
And the ways that women, I think, especially manifest that, and it's not always direct. I think men are so much more direct about their friendships, but women, I guess what I'm trying to say is I've tried in this book to look at sort of the dark shadow side of friendship, mm-hmm. even though they're working in a nightclub and it's sort of like you're in a Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers movie.
True. And even though when Ruby is cast in a movie and the war has just begun.
Yes.
And what has happened on December 9th at
7th.
In Hawaii, that has affected everybody.
Right.
So when she is cast and she has been playing I Am Chinese, not Japanese, and suddenly she's on the set and the director says there are two men in suits waiting to see you. And they say, you're Ruby, whatever the last name, and you're Japanese. Is your father a spy? Is your brother a spy? Were you spying? And they're all like standing with their mouth open. Now, Grace knew this, but she had never said anything. So when they take Ruby off, the director looks at Grace and says, listen, can you dance? Can you wear her costumes? And we're ready to roll.
Mm-hmm. You just summed it up.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And this was based in part on the true story of something that happened to a woman who named Dorothy Toy, who was billed as the Chinese Ginger Rogers. And she and her partner had gotten this big opportunity to be in a film, and one of their friends did rat her out to get her part. And so when the FBI came and the War mm-hmm. Relocation Authority officials came to her, they said, we'll give you a choice. Either we can send you to the internment camp where your family is, or you just need to leave the state. And so the real life Dorothy Toy spent the rest of the war traveling through the South, still performing as the Chinese Ginger Rogers. And what she said to me when I interviewed her was, no one had ever seen a Chinese, no one had ever seen a Japanese. I knew I would be safe there.
Yeah.
So I took part of her story, obviously, not all of it, but part of it, and was able to weave those real events into China Dolls.
Because later, when Helen seems to imply that Grace had ratted on her, and look, you had a career because of it. Yes, she did. But she didn't turn her in. So the question is, who did? But that's part of the murder mystery of the book. Yeah.
Yes. Yes, we can't give that part away.
I know it. And Joe, and meanwhile, has gone off to war, having made love to Grace, which is everything she ever dreamed of. And he had the hots for Ruby there, too, for a while.
He did. Yeah, he's a very interesting character. My old editor that I had for many, many books retired before I started China Dolls. And Bob, who was the editor for William Styron and Maya Angelou and people like that, when he was a young man, he was a flyer in the war. And so he was another one that I got to interview about his experiences.
Yeah.
And you know, what training was like here, mm-hmm. actually here in Southern California, and yeah. where he went, and when he was, you know, had free time, what clubs did he go yeah. to, and who did he see? So, I, you know, for me, I think fact really is stranger than fiction. Yeah. And so often the stories that I hear, you know, yeah. I would have to sort of change to make them believable as fiction.
Yeah, because Joe is injured in the war, and what does this do to a man's psyche?
Right.
And his sense of himself as a man.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Yes, and he has had in the past some anger issues, and what we would call today anger issues, and I don't think they had that post-traumatic stress syndrome label back then, yeah. but that doesn't mean that it didn't exist. Yeah. And so this was a time in our country, and I think that this comes through in China Dolls, where there was a lot of patriotism, obviously. Mm-hmm. Everybody was completely united during World yeah. War II.
And it was Chinese a time who did not want to be mistaken
right.
for Japanese.
Would wear yeah. armbands that would say things like that. But it was also a time of tremendous social change.
Yeah.
You know, where all of a sudden, if you're fighting next to people who are completely different than maybe the people that you grew yeah. up with in your small town in the mm-hmm. middle of the country, that people were being exposed to different cultures and races and food and yeah. everything during this time yeah. period. And one piece of that, of course, is the people you're fighting next to. But another is, how do you spend your free time when you're a service?
And they all in San Francisco, when they had free time, reached into the shell of Chinatown. Yeah.
Yes.
Is much of it left now?
Well, San Francisco Chinatown is still a very vibrant community. It's still one of the larger and more authentic Chinatowns in the United States. But the clubs are all gone. There's only one club, and even that one is more of a sort of bar cocktail lounge called the Lipo, which is still there on Grant Street. But all of those big nightclubs are gone, just as they are around the country. You know, that yeah. nightclub era ended. The war yeah. ended, the boys came home, they got yeah. married, they moved to the suburbs, and what yeah. came along? Television. And yeah. that was really the end of the nightclub era.
And even then, the girls are hired as the swing sisters by right. Ed Sullivan.
Yes.
I love that whole yes. part. Yeah.
Yeah. That was really fun to have that, and to have him as a character, yeah. just even though he makes a very short appearance.
Tell me about Lee Mortimer, because he was a well-known gossip columnist.
Mm-hmm. He was in New York. He worked for the New York Daily News, and he had a fondness for Asian women. Uh-huh. He married quite a few of them. He sponsored some women to come out of internment camps and bring them to New York, yeah. where he got them jobs as dancers. There was a nightclub in New York called the China Doll,
uh-huh.
and the chorus girls there were called Lee Mortimer's China Dolls.
Oh.
So he yeah. was a kind of a tough, hard-boiled guy. When I was doing research yeah. about him, he got into a big fist fight once with Frank Sinatra, and just yeah. you know, these were people
that was
who
an
were,
era.
That was exactly it was an yeah. era.
Who was the Chinese Frank Sinatra? Eddie? No.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, Eddie in this novel, his yeah. name is Eddie.
And Eddie is interesting because Eddie is living two lives.
Mm-hmm. But just as many of these characters are, I think, in many ways.
Yeah.
And yes, so he's, you know, a Chinese man who's a dancer in the 1930s who also happens to be gay.
Yeah. Helen and Eddie marry. And funnily enough, he ends up being closer to her family than
mm-hmm.
she is.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. You know, this is not an easy book. I mean, I see you with sort of a wall with characters, and what am I going to do with them in 10 years, in 7 years, trying to figure out how they all fit into each other.
Mm-hmm. Well, what I did was I mainly stayed with the girls themselves, and if you stay with that friendship, and then I do have this belief, it's not my own, but I believe this to be true, that history does have an effect on individual people. We tend to learn history in terms of wars and dates and battles and things like the Depression, but really history is something that happens to individual people. So if I had those three girls and history starts happening around them and to them, then all of their, you know, everything that happens to each girl individually, but also their friendships, whether it's two against one or all three of them on the same page at the same time, it made it very easy to follow what would happen to them.
I love the reunion at the end. And when Grace goes in and she sees this sort of chubby middle-aged man, and it's little boy Tommy grown up, wonderful touch. Yeah.
Yes. And that he had grown up to be very much like Eddie's father, which was sort of, you know, a twist, even though they're not actually blood related. Yeah. So I really loved that. And I loved being able to see all of those people again later in life, because, you know, I did spend 3 years going out and interviewing people. Yeah. So it gave me a way to sort of show what they're like today. Yeah. You know?
And even his daughter, who's a typical, you know, Ivy League kid coming in.
And she was very critical. She's very critical.
Yeah. How could you dare have danced in something they call China Doll?
Yes, exactly. And how did you like, you know, you always use that
as
being
an Oriental.
Called Oriental and all of that stuff. So it was a way to kind of look at that language, which actually I needed to use to be authentic.
Yeah.
But also she could then turn it on them and be so critical.
In writing it over 3 years and doing the interviews, what changed in the book?
Well, so many things change. You know, obviously when you talk to someone and they tell you something and you think, oh, that is so good, I'm going to have to try to use that. But I'm also always thinking about, you know, it's coming out of my imagination, too, so much of the story. So sometimes there's something that I would hear and I would just think, oh, I've got to use that. And then sometimes it's just I'm driving on the 405 and something pops into my mind, and I hate to admit it, but I'm one of those people who will pull out a piece of paper and write on the steering wheel so I don't forget it. And so there are always many turning points, I think, in a novel where you start out thinking, this is where it's going to go, this is how it's going to end. But I actually didn't know who had ratted out Ruby, for example, until very close to the end. Very, very close. I mean, for the longest time, I thought it was one. Then I switched over to the other. Then I thought, oh, that one's too obvious. I'm going to go back over here. And I think even in their final argument, it's sort of guilt and accusations are sort of switching and twisting throughout that whole scene.
It's interesting because from that scene on, they could work together, but it was never the same.
Right.
Yeah.
And yet, I think they have this sense, and I have this with friends, some friends myself, where we were very, very close when we were in junior high school or college. And we don't see each other very much now. But when we do see each other, there's that automatic connection where you go to that place when you were 15 and hanging out and staying up all night in the bedroom and giggling and talking.
And
they knew you when, exactly. Yeah. They knew you when. They knew you when you were still your sort of purest self before your real life got onto you too
and
much.
And you know which one also may have ratted you out on something, which is you're glad to see him, and you maybe never brought it up in conversation, but it was always there.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right. I think that that's true, and I think we all have relationships and friendships like that. So, you know, hopefully people will read this, and even though it's in nightclubs, and even though they're dancers, and even though the war is going on and all of that, that they ought to be able to really connect to these friendships and to the emotions.
Lisa, you wrote on Gold Mountain.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that was your family.
Yes.
Or part of the family. any of the people as you were interviewing them, the ones who were in their 90s, had they known your family at all?
Well, most of these people were working in San Francisco, and my family was here in Los Angeles. So I don't recall that there was any connection.
Yeah.
Although there was a woman who was the Chinese Sally Rand.
Yeah.
And she lived here in Los Angeles. And I used to see her all the time. And I'm sure she knew my family. I mean, they all knew her.
Yeah.
So, but I think that would have been the only one. And unfortunately, I didn't realize she was the Chinese Sally Rand until after she passed away.
Oh.
So I never got to interview her about her life.
People are going to love this book because it's a book. There aren't that many where people sit and have written something like this, and I thank you. Will you autograph my
Absolutely.
Book?
Absolutely, thank you.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns, but support your local library. Whatever you can do, support it. I mean, there are such great books that Lisa has written, and I mean, it goes back to even when she was part of Monica Highland. And that was, I hope someday you're going to write about that era.
Yes.
That was when a young little Lisa was co-authoring with her mother Carolyn C. and John Espy. Wonderful book, fun book. And then her books recently with the Friends, the other books, the Shanghai Girls, great. So you'll find it in your library, but whatever you do, support it. It is our greatest democratic institution. What did a library mean to you growing up?
Everything.
Everything.
Just everything. It opened all the world to me.
Thank you. Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you.
And we'll see you next time.